you any legs on the bench in the deadlifts. What have you got to do? And that jab on the pad is an exceptional jab. It's a shocking jab.
I've got you. A bit deeper. You need it easy enough, come on, get used to the weight now. Come on, get down, that's it. Keep going.
Okay, now stand up. Head up. Now come down on it. Did you last set? Down a bit more, but anyway. Down a bit more. That's it, good one there. And again. One more. Last one, give me a good one. Hold your breath in on the way down. Push that the way up.
Tyson, training today, is it just, your strength training just ticking over before you go over to Holland?
Yeah, we got back yesterday for a fight that's going on tomorrow with my cousins and my brother. And today was just legs, so we've been doing quite heavy legs today. We do like different body parts every day in the mornings, followed by like cardio session in the afternoon and then boxing training at night. So three times a day, heavy work.
Yeah, you're putting yourself through the pain now, aren't you?
My legs were killing me, they were burning off. And them heavy weights were really heavy, getting me back everything. So the heavier the weight, the harder it is. So money's going to build strength and power, so it's all good.
We were saying now, you're in a bit of a different place now than you was a few years ago. You know, you can see that you're really, you're stepping up yourself to a different level here now, and, you know, the condition you're in goes without saying.
Yeah, you know, if you want to be a champion, you've got to train like one, eat like one, act like one. And for the past year, I've been training non-stop and dedicating life to boxing, really, where in the past I've been eating what I want, doing what I want, and going out partying, drinking, all that sort of stuff. And I've just had to nail that on the head now and get stuck into boxing if I want to be a world champion. It's all right being a domestic level fighter, like a British champion or a Commonwealth or a European level, but when you're stepping up into world level, I'm like number six in the world now, so it's everyone's tweaks. There's only inches and little steps between winning and losing fights, so you got to train like the best if you want to be the best.
What was it that, you know, clicked? What made you think, you know, because I know you was going, you know, you're unbeaten and you've obviously been saying you're going to be, what you're going to be, and you're going to be the world champion and all that, but what actually made you click and think, I've got to be serious here, because I'm...
Well, to be honest about it, it was after the Padgett fight, really, I decided that I wasn't going to do any more training with my uncle, Yui, or any other trainers, really, and I was just going to pack it in, boxing. Because I wasn't getting what I wanted out of boxing, really. I was basically just doing it for a few quid at the end. And not doing it because I loved it. I was doing boxing at that stage. I had no confidence in anything I was doing, really. I knew I should have been training hard. And I knew I should have been doing things differently, but I was still doing them anyway. It's like when I was going down the town drinking. I knew I shouldn't be doing it, staying out till 5 in the morning and all that. But I was just doing it anyway, eating junk and thinking, oh, fuck, it'd be all right. And then getting in the ring, out of shape, fat as anything. And then breathing out my ass after two rounds. So it's one of them things where you just think, if you want to do something in life, knuckle down. And if you just want to be like the average person, keep doing what you're doing. So I want to be a level above that. I put all the hard work in, and I was 17-0. So it was just a matter of getting stuck in and dedicating life, really. There's not much else out there when you take all the going out and drinking and socialising out of things.
It shows you, really, doesn't it? Like you say, you wasn't taking it as seriously, but you stayed unbeaten and you was going into fights, not prepared, and basically, you know, it was you could have lost some of them fights, really, when you look back, couldn't you?
100%. Like, I was going into fighters ranked in the top 15 in the world. Like, that Brazilian I knocked out, Nascimento, he was the WBO number 14. The night before the weigh-in, I was out till 5 in the morning with my cousin, drinking champagne in on Deansgate. So, and then we went up there for the weigh-in, jumped in the ring and fought and knocked him out in 5 rounds. So if I can do that sort of thing, doing these stupid things, what can I do if I do it properly? Which I have been doing, you've been seeing the results, so just on to bigger and better things in the future.
You know, you're a fighter, you came into the world fighting June 1988, you were born 7 weeks premature, you know, it's been well documented, you died 3 times during childbirth, you know. Your first battle was for life, so, you know, seems you're always destined to be a fighter.
You know, I think it was always on the cards for me, really. I do believe it's destiny for me, and I know you can talk a lot to, like, get press and all that, but I don't need to do that anymore because I'm a big name in boxing now, so I don't need to tell any lies or anything. And I do believe it was my destiny to become a champion boxer because, like you say, I had that struggle at birth to survive and all that. I was always a weakling growing up and all that, and very thin and whatever, bullied and all that sort of stuff. And my name was Tyson. I had 3 other brothers. They're not called Tyson, they're not boxers. And why me? So you knit it all together, it does sort of think, well, it's supposed to be. And here I am today boxing.
And you know, as a kid, what was you like as a kid? Was you know, your dad? You come from a boxing family. Your dad was a boxer. Your uncles are all boxers. Like, say, your cousins and that. You know, as a kid, did you feel like he was going to box? Or
no? I don't know if you know about dogs, like, but the only way I could explain myself is like a young pit bull. Yeah, they're scared of their own shadow. That's what I was. I was timid as anything. A Jack Russell could make me run away, type of thing. If you know what I mean. I wasn't a fighter. If you know what I mean. I was just a tall, gangly kid, and if you said boo to me, I'd cry. And once they get past that age of 2-year-old, they turn savage, don't they? So I think once I got to the age of, like, where I'd become a bit manly in myself, say 16, where I was getting punched in the face in the gym and not crying, I'm thinking, right, you're going to have it now. I think that's when it sort of broke, and that's when I knew I was going to be a fighter. Because up until I was 14, I wasn't a fighter. I've been to the gym and had spars and stuff with, like, people in the boxing gym, but I never fought a box amateur because all my cousins, like Ophi and Chasey and all them, were all boxers. But they started at, like, 9 years old, 8 and 9, 7, some of them. And my dad never had an amateur fight, so I always thought I'd just turn pro like he did. But I got to 14 and we've been looking for a local gym, me and my brother Shane. And there was a young lad there and he said, oh, there's a gym in Wivenshaw. We said, nah, there's not a gym in Wivenshaw, or else we'd know about it, because we only live 2 miles up the road. He said, definitely. He said, it's called Ringway Boxing Club. I said, right, take us here then. 6 o'clock, he said, it's that. I said, you take us here now then. I said, so anyway, we walked down to the gym. It was 2.5 mile walk there. Gets there, and Jimmy Egan, that's when I first met Jimmy Egan and Steve. And we was outside in a big playground in Ringway Primary School. And I was running around the playground with, like, the kids at the beginning. I was, like, tall, 6'5" at 14. And they noticed me straight away, if you know what I mean, like the way I was running for an heavyweight and so tall and whatever. And they said, have you ever boxed before? And I said, no, but my dad has. And he knew my dad because years before that, my dad was sparring down there with Jimmy Kelly years ago. And so they knew me dad from then, when it was Ben Chill down at the Ben Chill pub at the roundabout. And so they knew who I was, but they never knew I boxed or anything, which I didn't. So went there a few times, played outside with the kids and messing around. And then Steve said, right, come on, you've been up level to the boxing side of it. So I thought that was great. And then I got a certificate saying I passed me boxing, like, basics. Medical, yeah. I had to throw a jab and a 1-2 and all that. And, you know, I was a part of something for the first time ever. I always, like, wanted to prove that I could do it, if you know what I mean. It was like a chip on my shoulder that I always was told that we couldn't box, if you know what I mean. I think my dad was, like, a mental psychology person with the kids. If you said you couldn't do it, I'd go and do it, if you know what I mean. So I think that's what his aim was in life, to say, like, you couldn't do that, so I'd go out and prove that I could. So the biggest thing I wanted to do was go and get a medical card and have an amateur fight, just to say to me, Dad, right, I'm boxing on Saturday. And I got to the age of, like, I was training there for about a year, and nobody really knew that we was going there, just me and my little brother Shane, and the baby who's now 6'1" and 15 stone, he was like 7 years old with a long ponytail down his back, fat as anything. So we used to go there and train, and I remember one night I was supposed to, I was, first time ever, I got my medical and I was going to go on a spec, it's called, where you go down with a local boxing team and you go and have like, you go and weigh in, and if there's anybody there to have a fight with, you have your first fight. And I told everybody, I'm definitely fighting tonight, Bradbury Hall, definitely fighting, when I had some shorts done and everything, yeah. And I remember like 30 or 40 people turned up and never ended up fighting because there was nobody there for me to fight. And that was a disappointment. So ever since then, I've just been training and training. And the old Jimmy used to put a lot of time into me at the beginning, you know, like he used to come and pick me up every Sunday morning to go down to Chorlton Water Park and do the runs around there, and sprints up the hill and pad work and all that sort of stuff. We used to go to Stockport, he used to call it Hell Park, up them steps in Stockport and carrying people on your back. I've been through a lot of training, different training techniques and stuff as a kid. And I have my dad and my uncles and all that taking me on the pads and showing me a few things and whatever. And then, but nobody really took much notice then, if you know what I mean. Until I had a few fights. I had my first amateur fight when I was 16. I was training from 14, 2 years without a fight. It was a bit sickening, really. And my first amateur fight when I was 16, RAF Witten, Peterborough. And I boxed the one who beat the other lad. So I was like the number one junior super heavyweight in the country after one fight. So it was amazing, really. Yeah. And then I had another fight, two, three fights. And there was one that sticks out most to me. There was a kid from Widnes. His name was Adam Makaj or Makish or something. And his nickname was the Facebreaker, because in his previous fight before me, he was 17 and he boxed a man who was like 32 and like broke his face bone, broke his jaw, smashed his eye socket and all that. And I remember Steve saying in the gym, this Facebreaker's gonna, if you don't train hard and do this, he's gonna end up doing it to you. So I remember like training and working on things, and I went down there and boxed his head off, really. And then I entered into the novice championships when I was 17, because they suspended the junior ABA division super heavyweight for that year only. That's the only time they've done it in 30 years, because they had a meeting down in London and they assumed that I was 25 when I was 16, so they said, we're not going to let him beat up a little 16 year old kid in the junior ABA, 17. So I went in there with the men and I come out on top, really. It was a bit strong for me, like it was bullying me around, but I was just out boxing up, you know what I mean, with air speed and movement. And then I got selected to go and box for England, and from then I never looked back, really. I was boxing for England quite a few times. I went to loads of tournaments and that. And while I was back in Manchester, I used to train with Steve at Jimmy Egan's Boxing Academy. It had changed three times since then. It was, when I first started, it was Ringway Primary School. Then it went to Crossacres School, and then it ended up on Jim Egan's Boxing Academy on Rawthorne Road in Bentrill. So that's where we ended up staying. Me and Steve put a lot of work into things for a load of years, you know, practicing pad works, bar bags, everything. And he's had a lot of influence on my early career, Steve. Yeah, from the beginning, he taught me basically everything I knew.
I know, they fought a lot of you, didn't they? And
yeah,
he always, you know, spoke highly of you. It was, I think I'd mentioned before to you that when I first come, he pointed you out to me. He said, that kid over there, how old do you think he is? I think he was 17 then.
Yeah.
He looked a lot older, obviously, and he said he'll be a world champion one day. So,
yeah, you know, ever since I had one fight, he was saying, oh, he's going to be heavyweight champion of the world to everybody he come across. So it was good times, you know. We had some good times together, me and Steve and that. And it didn't work out as a pro, really, because I think we spent so much time together from being 14 to, say, 16, 17. It was, I learned all he had to show, if you know what I mean. So I needed to go up a level. I needed to get a better trainer, if you know what I mean. Like, to show some something different. And Stevie wanted to keep going and doing the same things, so we ended up growing apart really. So that's how that finished. So then I turned pro after being disappointed about the Olympics in 2008. Tried to qualify through Ireland, which they didn't let me. And I had two fights for Ireland as a nation, for Ireland against USA and against Poland. I won them both. But then when it come to going into the national championships, they wouldn't let me. But I've already boxed for Ireland as a nation. So it was a fix, you know what I mean? So then I come back and before the Olympics I was national champion, ABA champion in England, senior champion. Still didn't get a box offer, a selection or a qualifier or nothing. By then David Price had qualified, so good luck to him with that one. And I was just left in the cold really, so I was ABA champion, but to be honest, I didn't want to box anymore then, because I went through a lot of political stuff with the amateur boxing. And I wasn't getting the right opportunities I should have done. And I didn't get a chance to go and box in a qualifier for Beijing or nothing, so it was one of them. I thought I'd been hard done by, if you know what I mean, which, I don't know, maybe I had, maybe I hadn't, when I look back on it now. I was only 18, and I only had a handful of fights. I had about 30 fights, 34 fights, where David Price was like 20-odd, and open class international, been to the World Championships, Europeans. He tried qualify for a previous Olympics, so maybe he was the number one selection, but I never got the chance anyway to prove it wrong or right. I had a fight with him when I was when I only had about 12 amateur fights, and he was an open class international in 2006, 2 years before. This was when I was a kid, when I just started boxing. I've always been the same. I didn't care who I boxed. I just get in there and fight. So everyone said, "Oh, don't take David Price. He'll knock you out. He's too old and he's too experienced." My dad said, "Listen, it's a man with a pair of gloves on. If you can fight, you can fight. And if you can't, you can't fight. So get in there. If he knocks you out, you're no good. And if he doesn't, you're all right." Mm. So me being who I am, jumped in there and got stuck in. But it was too experienced for me, really. I was a big kid swinging big hooks and trying to knock him out. And I almost did at one stage. And he was just too experienced, you know. And he beat me fair and square in 2008. He beat me by 22-8. But I'd come on a lot. I went to the European Championships, got a silver medal, got robbed in the final. Got a bronze in the Worlds, which I thought I should have won the World Championships completely. I had a lot of open class international fights, and I won a lot of them, you know what I mean? I lost 4 out of 36. Most of them were internationals, so...
I mean, you was ranked number 3 in the world as well.
Yeah, number 3 in the world. I beat the American number 1. I beat numerous champions, if you know what I mean. And still never got the chance, so... 2008, after the Olympics, I was just gutted, if you know what I mean. I just thought 4 years to the next Olympics, which should have been this one. So I just thought, sack this. I was finished with boxing. We went on holiday. We went to Tenerife, me and my cousins, like on a lad's holiday for a week. I was getting married at the same time. I had a split up with a girlfriend and thought, sack it, we're going on a lad's holiday to Tenerife. So we all went over there, had a booze up for 7 days and party and all that, as you do. And liked it that much, come back for a day, and then went again for another week to Greece, Malia for a week. Same thing over there. Put on a load of weight, wasn't bothered. Never took it seriously at all, amateur boxing. Not even as a senior, international or anything like that. I just faffed around it and I won them. It was just something I'd done naturally, was win. I knew how to win when I was in the ring. Mostly because I stopped him or knocked him out. And apart from a few dodgy decisions abroad and that, which you can't help for, it was all good. It was a good amateur career, but bitter, like I said before. So get back onto the story. Come back from over there, and my uncle Huey had been speaking to a couple of promoters and that, and he set up a meeting with Mick Hennessy. And he said, "Right, we're going to Carl Froch's training camp in Ireland. Hennessy's got some sparring, some big fat Cuban," he said. But I knew, I never boxed a Cuban, but I knew the reputation he had, so I thought, oh, no problem. I'd come back from holiday drinking for 2 weeks, and fast as a big 21 or 2 stone. So goes over to Ireland, and it's only Mike Perez, the Cuban, like, top heavyweight, yeah? he's ripped and he's 80, he's 8-0 at the time. So gets in there, first day, has a spar with him, 50-50. So I thought, nobody can give me a 50-50 spar. So the next day, Yui gets in the corner, and I beats him up, this Perez, and then Mick Hennessy's like, over the moon, blah, blah, blah. And he comes back. But in the meanwhile, we was talking to other promoters, such as like Barry McGuigan was going to be my promoter. My Uncle Yui was on the phone to Richard Schaefer in America. Frank Warren, everybody really, Frank Maloney. We went down on a meeting, me, Peter and my dad, with Frank Maloney.
So you're not sure what promoters they all wanted to sign you?
No, I was a national like name when I was an amateur, if you know what I mean. People heard of Tyson Fury when I was an amateur, so I was a national champion as well, so wasn't a shortage of promoters. So we ended up doing a deal with McGuigan at the beginning, and we shook hands on it and all that, and in the end of it, just it didn't have a fighting offer, he didn't have a manager's license, so I thought, I'm just faffing around here, I'm going to get fatter and fatter, I'm not going to be working, I'm not doing nothing. So Mick Hennessy had a television then as well, he had ITV at the time, and it just seemed like the right thing to do. Terrestrial television, everyone kept saying terrestrial TV is better than Sky and everything, so I went with Mick Hennessy, went on honeymoon, and come back, cut the honeymoon short to 6 days, and it was supposed to be 10 days. Come back and fought and had my first pro debut on the Frotch undercard, and from then I boxed all over the world in that.
Yeah, yeah. You turned pro, they had 9 fights in the first year, so you...
Yeah, I was really busy in the first year, 9 fights, could have boxed every month, could have had 15 fights, 12 fights, but I got a back injury, and we ended up boxing 9 times, which was still a lot really. And it was like I've only fitted another one more in the next 3 years after that, so to get me to 19. So there we have it, pro career.
Offered the shot at the English title against John McDermott. You know, when you look back on it, John was an experienced fighter. You know, a good seasoned pro, and
yeah.
You know, it was probably. Do you think it was a bit early to have been going in with him then? Or?
First year of boxing, it was my 7th pro fight I fought McDermott in. First year,
yeah.
So it was too soon really, but anyway we jumped in the ring and they had a fight, and it was a close fight, you know, could have went either way, so the board ordered the rematch, and I wanted a rematch more than anything because people were saying I'd lost and whatever, and you know we can't do anything about decisions and anything, so I just wanted to put the record straight. I didn't have to, no one was forcing me to do it, but I wanted to go back and do it, and another big Rickus in the training again, coming at 20 stone, 19 stone 7 coming at. I'd done about 2 weeks training. I'd have fought him straight away in the rematch, but we had a fight pro debut in Ireland, and they were boxed on a world title undercard over there, and the Bernard Dunn undercard, and I broke my hand in that fight against some Czech Republic champion, and the rematch with McDermott was postponed for a long time, so it never actually happened until 2010 June or something, and by then they'd had another fight as well in between, and then had the McDermott rematch, and knocked him out 9. So it went on from there really, and that made me mandatory for the British title, so Chisora had to fight me within 90 days, which he didn't fight me for about another 9 months, never mind 90 days, because he had the Klitschko fracas and he was going to fight him and he wasn't and blah blah blah, and then he ended up defending against Sam Sexton, but I got my shot anyway.
I mean, you was chasing that shot with Chisora, British and Commonwealth titles again, that pretty early in your career really, but you know you was
14 fights, youngest ever British and Commonwealth heavyweight champion.
Yeah, it's some achievement really when you think you was amateur at 16. And what you've just said, you know, it has been a bit of a whirlwind. But do you feel that? Do you ever feel any pressure that people, you know, the fans, the public, whatever, you know, are pushing you along a bit quicker than maybe?
No, you know, it's only up to myself if I want to do it or not. And you know, there's always going to be pressure when you've been brought up, you've been weaned on terrestrial television. My first fight was on television, so and everyone's seen me from the beginning, and they'll see me to the end because I'm a television fighter, and. So it's, if you see someone from being a kid and they're growing up and getting mature and better and better and better, so I think it's a good thing, but there is pressure as well, you know, because you've got to perform to your best ability every time, which now is not a problem, but in the past it was, where now I can't wait to get in there and perform better and better, because I know I'm doing the right training, I'm doing the right conditioning, eating, everything, so it's not a problem anymore where it was in the past.
And the Chisora fight and the decision to, obviously it was a great opportunity for you, it paid off because you won it, and you know, like you say, the youngest British champion, it was a big achievement for you, and you must be so proud that night.
Yeah, you know, it was a big achievement. There was a lot of emotions flying around, and my dad had just got locked up, so it was sort of a dedication fight and all that. And we put a lot of work in, you know, me and my uncle Huey, and the lads down at the gym in Morecambe. And, you know, we was down in London running up the Salt Hills and things like that in Luton, and we'd done a lot of sparring and training. We started 3 months out for that fight. And, you know, he got me in fantastic shape, and I was fit, fittest I've ever been in my life for that night. Huey did, and it was just went perfect, you know. I beat him every round, and I beat him at his own fight, really. I bullied him backwards, and I always said, if what happens to bullies if you stand up to them, they fold. And he was a bully, he had the bully mentality, and that was his thing. Like, he swagged around, and he was Derek Chisora, and he beat up people and whatever, and like I always said, when you stand up to him, you fold. And I stood up to him, pushed him back, and he folded, really. And if it wouldn't have been for me two hands being broke, both of them broke both hands in the fight, I'd have knocked him out. But I'll settle for a 10-2 decision on points anyway.
So you broke both your arms.
Broke both hands, yeah.
A tough head, Derek. I mean, he proved that.
He's got a head like rock.
Yeah.
But I was bouncing rights and left off his... I broke the right hand early on in the fight, I think the second round. So a lot of the fight was jabs and stuff, and when I did throw the right hand, it was immense pain, so...
You couldn't open up on him anyway?
No, no. From then, I've had hand problems. I've been having, like, physio and stuff on my hands, and they seem to be all right now, but in the past it would have been a bit iffy, but it seemed to be okay at the moment.
I mean, it shows you that Chisora win, you know, he went on to... perform really well against Klitschko and you know, make a name for himself,
that
really.
That could have been my fight if I wanted it. I could have already had a world title shot now, because both Klitschko's said before the Chisora fight, whoever wins out of Fury and Chisora, we want to fight the winner. So they contacted us and said, listen, he won, blah, 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 we'll fight him in Germany under our terms, under our promotion, under our banner. No chance. Not for me. I wasn't ready. I can get a world title shot in the morning. It's not about that, getting a title shot for me. I want to go there and win a world title. I don't want to make up some numbers or put up a good fight like Chisora did. I want to win it, you know. And at the moment, the present time, it's easy to get a world heavyweight title shot. Me being 6'9", white, Irish connections, undefeated in 19 fights, I could get one any time I want. But you know, why take a fight when you're not ready for a fight? You know, I wouldn't say I'm not ready. I could go in there and pop a tussle now and maybe knock one of them out, you know what I mean, with a big punch, because it's heavyweight boxing. But I do believe in another four fights or something, I'll be even more ready, you know. And there's no rush. I'm 24 years old, and one's 40, one's 36. Time's on my side, not theirs. You know, if they go, they go, and if they're still there when I'm ready, then they're still there, you know. But I won't let anybody rush me, and I won't be rushed into things that I don't want to do. Like the David Price fight, you're right, I was British and Commonwealth champion, and he was made mandatory by knocking McDermott out. And at the time, I wasn't training. I was 23 stone, and it was mandatory, and all right, I vacated the titles, but what else did they expect me to do? Because I had 60 days to fight Price, I was 23 stone, and I wasn't training, so I obviously had to vacate. And from then I got training with my uncle Peter about March 2012, and never looked back. Brilliant conditioner, boxing, everything. And I had the Rogan fight April. No, started 3 months we were training for the Rogan fight, and I come in the lowest weight ever, in fantastic shape, boxed brilliantly, southpaw. And from then it's just been excellent, really. We had another good training camp with Vinnie Madalone, good sparring, great shape again. And then here I am today, you know, and looking at fighting Ruslan Chagaev in my next fight, former world champion. He's lost two out of about 28 to Klitschko and Povetkin, both world champions. And one of them was on point, so if I can go in there and beat him, then you know, like I say, I'm not rushing for a world title. I don't want to be mandatory at the moment, if you know what I mean. We can get mandatory. We could probably make this fight an eliminator for the world title with Shagaev, because he's on that level. But I don't want to. I've just won the WBO Intercontinental, and I also won the Irish title as well. So I'm picking up titles along the way, and I'm learning. I'm still learning my career, and I'm not rushing. No one's going to make me rush into anything, especially not for money. You know, in the beginning, I was boxing, and I thought, oh, I'll get a few quid out of this game, yeah. And, you know, it's not about money, because plenty of people out there, I've said this a lot of times in interviews, there's plenty of people with a few quid in the world, and money don't make people people. I've never had any money, so I don't know what it's like to have any, if you know what I mean. So I'm not really interested in money. It's not going to make me a different person anyway, you know. So I'm not rushing. And if I do win the world title, when I do, it's going to be for a lot of money anyway. So other things come to those who wait.
There's more of a plan, isn't there, though, you know, where you're going. And you know, a lot of people are calling out the Klitschko's, but I know you've got a lot of respect for them guys, and you know, they're kind of the blueprint that you're following yourself. So, you know, you want to do it the right way, and you want to get there, and when you do get there, you stay there.
Yeah, that's it. A lot of people are calling them out and that, and calling them robots and whatever. And you know, in the past, I've often said things about myself that I regret saying now, and said, like, oh, the just things to try and get myself up there, and like try and get people to take notice, you know. And when you're on a high level, you just realise that what an idiot you can be sometimes when you're young and that. And I look at these fighters, and when they're calling them names and saying they're has-beens and they're useless and they wouldn't stand up to the greats and that, I just want to go there, show them full respect, you know what I mean? Turn up in a nice suit, all clean shaven, hair done, everything, you know what I mean? And go in there as a sensible, upstanding person and conduct myself in a proper manner, how heavyweight champions or contenders should do, you know? Go in there, shake the fella's hand, and say, look, you've been a great, great champion. I respect you to the heavens. And, you know, I'm here, and I'm really ready for a fight now. And I'm going to give it my best shot. I made the best man win. Good luck, and God bless you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think people always think, well, this is it. This is how it's supposed to be conducted. I know they always put up a good show of themselves. Even in press club, when people slapping them, spitting in the faces, they never struck out or done anything. So they're good role models for kids and anywhere the world. Mm. And, you know, I believe the heavyweight champion of the world should be like that. He shouldn't be a badass, bad boy, gangster rapper. You know what I mean? He should be an upstanding, straight goer. You know what I mean? Like somebody who people can look up to and want to be like. Mm. I know controversiality makes people interested and people like that sort of thing, and it sells papers and people will tune in, but I don't know, I want to be different, you know, to all the big mouths and everyone screaming and shouting what they're going to do and what they're not going to do. And I've been the biggest mouth in boxing for years, if you know what I mean. I've been often called the biggest mouthpiece in the world, along with Max Clifford, when we was doing it together, me and him. And you know, I realise now that I don't need to talk anymore. You know, 19 straight wins, 14 KOs. I'm just going to let me training, me boxing do the talking. I'm not talking any more fights into big fights, you know. People know who I am. If they want to watch me, they'll watch a good fight, because I always give value for money, entertainment in me fights. And they know they're going to see a good fight, so I don't need to blag it up anymore or scream and shout that I'm something or whatever. I can just get in there and people can see for themselves what they're getting and what they're not getting.
You know, you're a big boxing fan yourself, yeah, aren't you? And you know that the true boxing fans know the score. You speak through your boxing, and obviously I've been doing that as well. And you know, you pretty much promote yourself out of the ring. You know, your name goes before you, and you know, yeah, you're a big guy, and you've got all the attributes to be a good fighter. So I think, you know, do you think it's time you'll knuckle down now? And
you know, we've been knuckling down now for the best part of a year. Not really, I've done much media attention or anything, you know. Where before I had the agent, PR agent Max Clifford, and I was going in the papers and magazines, and I was living a bit of a celebrity lifestyle. I was going to celebrity parties, and I was doing all sorts of things like that, if you know what I mean, which is good for public relations, but not good when you're supposed to be training. Now I've cut all that out. I've not done so much anything like that in the past year, and just select interviews, if you know what I mean. And that's it, really. I've just been knuckling down training, and from now for the past year we've just been concentrating on what we've got to do. We know how to do it and we know what we've got to do, so I'm happy. I think that's the most important thing. I've done a lot of travelling in the boxing. I must have had 10 trainers in 4 years of being a pro, if you know what I mean. I've been up and down, I've been in America, I've been in Canada, I've been in Austria, I've been in Germany, I've been in England, I've been in Scotland, well, I've been all over the island, I've been everywhere. I've trained with a lot of different trainers, world-class trainers, trainers nobody's heard of, trainers who's amateur trainers. I've trained everywhere, I'm with everybody. And, you know, I'm more happy and settled now than I've ever been, ever. So I think once you're an happy person, you're an happy life, and you've got your family. I've got my wife and kids, and that I'm settled down. I'm not looking for women and going out boozing and all that. So that helps as well. And I know what I've got to do. I'm in this gym training. I'm out there sleeping, eating, and I'm back in the gym training. There's nothing that's going to knock me off course now. I'm totally focused on my job.
Yeah, working with them different trainers and that, have you took something from each of them as well? It's been a good experience and a learning curve.
It's been a brilliant experience, you know, because I've been all over the world training, like I said, with all top trainers and everybody. You know, if you take a little bit something from every trainer, which I have done, I think you can be an all-round fighter, you know. I've had the experience of being out in Detroit in a Krog gym, where it's rough as anything, and everyone can fight. I've had the experience of being out there, and I went out to Canada training, sparring, fighting over there. You know, and if you can take little bits and pieces that each different trainer shows you, I think all these trainers have had a little add to me over the things, and they've made me the fighter I am today, so everyone deserves credit for what they do.
And, you know, the last two fights, you've really shown a big improvement. You've been with Peter. What has your Uncle Peter added to your game? I mean, it's been quite a transition, the way you boxed in the Rogan fight, you know, switching to southpaw. You've shed loads of weight. And, you know, there has been a significant improvement in your boxing. You know, what have you been working on with Peter, and what does he add to your game?
Well, I'll tell you what, it's more like it's a relationship, yeah. It's a family relationship, and it's also like Emmanuel Stewart and Vladimir Klitschko, they've got a top relationship going on where they sit down and they talk about things and everything like that, and we're sort of similar, the same, you know. We talk about everything. We talk about the boxing side of things. When we're training, after the training we'll sit down and we'll think, right, you need to turn a bit more or twist your shoulders, and you know, he's not afraid to say anything to me like, oh, I'm going to leave or whatever. If he sees it, he'll say it, you know, like. And I'm confident in what he's saying's right. If he tells me to do them squats, for instance, yeah, I believe what he's saying. If I'm not doing them right, I'll try my best to do what he's trying to say. Where in the past, I was thinking about trainers. He's trying to tell me, and he don't know himself. I had that in the back of my mind. So how can you take a person like that serious? So that's why I was coming unstuck a bit. But now, everything's right. I'm listening to what he's saying, I'm eating correctly, everything. The boxing side of things been, we've done a lot of things with boxing, me and Peter, yeah. We've went back to basics, really. Ever since I walked through the door of the gym when I was 14, I could throw 10 punch combinations. I was a natural combination puncher. I had screws, I had every punch in the book when people was learning a jab and a 1-2. But I never learnt the basics. I walked in the gym fully qualified, yeah, you know what I mean, like, I had already knew how to fight and throw combinations and slip and slide when I was a kid. I had that natural talent to do it, but I never worked on the basic standing straight, 1-2, jab, I never worked on the basic stuff, what you learn at the beginning, because I was so advanced when I walked into the gym. I was like a fighter who'd had 20, 30 fights already, the way I moved, the way I boxed, but I never did learn the fundamentals of boxing until this year, which is crazy because I had 17 fights British Commonwealth champion and still didn't know how to throw a jab or footwork or anything. So it's amazing, isn't it? So we just went back to basics, really. We stripped all the fancy stuff off.
It's like stepping out of the ring with Madelone yesterday. He's in the same shape as that now. So what's it going to be like in another 3 months? That's what people don't understand. He's at that level. It took a year to get there. When did we start this? 3.5 months before the...
February, when we started.
Rogan. Rogan was the 7th of July, wasn't he?
Yeah.
So 3.5 months before then. to come down from 23 and a half stone, yeah? To, he was 17, what was he for Rogan? 17 and a half?
Yeah.
17 and a half.
That's some weight to shift, wasn't it?
Six and a half stone.
But in that first camp, yeah, it was almost, a lot of it, was shedding the weight.
Yeah.
Following.
Yeah.
We were doing other things as well. But now, in the after Rogan, it's all been boxing and conditioning, not dieting. So now, this is why, in the Madalone fight, you see even better again.
Yeah.
Because he's not, the diet now is out the window. Because it's not a worry about pulling all the fat off. Now, he's building his body all the time.
So the training camp was to lose the weight, you know.
First training camp, you'd be on that running machine for an hour and a half. Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Skipping for an hour. You know, yeah. Give you an idea, what people don't see, yeah. He had a sweatsuit on, right? This is 15 kilos, this vest. He'd have that on, he'd skip for 30 minutes, run for an hour. Run for 30 minutes, skip for an hour with that on. Twice a day. So that's the level to get now.
So like, you know, now you're straight into the camp, you're on the weight already, you can just concentrate on your boxing.
There's no bin liners, there's no bags, you know, he's eating as much food as he can eat. And now, he's just pumping the weights, he does cardio in the afternoon, and it's a 2-hour boxing session in the evening. Yeah. So he's a dedicated professional because he's all day, he's training, all day. If he's not training, he's eating and sleeping, that's it. And that's what you've got to be a champion, isn't it?
We're in a good place at the moment. I'm mentally stable, focusing on boxing, we're working on basics. And I think that's the most important thing, the basics. Everyone forgets about the basics, but we're back working on the basic things about boxing, and it's working.
Your next fight now is November. It's looking like it's going to be Chagiev, he's a former WBA heavyweight champion. It'll be a good test for you if that one comes off, and it'll be a fight you'd have to be switched on for that. But it's a world class opponent, so it gives you the level what you're at.
Yeah, he's in the top 10 in the world, and he's been a world champion. He's experienced, you know, and I'm sure he's going to give me a tough fight, you know, and hopefully may the best man win.
I mean, there's been plenty of other names brandished about, John McCormack and people of that ilk, but, you know, it's Chagiev one you want. You think he's the best of the lot who's been...
I think he beat McCormack, and you've got people like Adam Eck who's avoiding the fight. They've been nailed down on contracts and they won't sign. And people like Lahovic, people like that. So I think Chagiev's the best one. He's a natural heavyweight, you know, he's not moved up through weights. And he's an experienced campaigner.
You know, everyone's been calling him out recently. James Toney's been having a pop at you, and you know, he's, I'm sure he's someone you've admired throughout your life as a boxer. You know, as a fan of boxing, obviously. So
James Toney, yeah, great fighter in the past. Moved up through the divisions again, but what can I say? He's too old at the moment. He's finished. Should retire and become a Hall of Famer, become a trainer or a manager or something. Not interested in the fight with Toney at all. Serious health problems if he wants to fight.
What key things have you took from the first part of your career? You know, what have you learned and what experiences have you taken that will stand you in good stead in the second sort of chapter of your career?
I think I've took the most important things are the ability to know what it's like to be under pressure, know what it's like unfit, being hurt, being down. I think I've had good grounding with the undefeated fighters I fought early on. And it's gonna hold me up in good stead for the future.
And you know, you're still 24. It seems like you've been around for a while now. And you know, your determination, your goal is to one day achieve the heavyweight championship of the world. It's a focus that you set out to do, and you're certainly on the right course.
Definitely. At first, it was a dream, and I'll be working towards that throughout the rest of my career. So it's all good, you know. I'm looking forward to the big fights in the future.
And, you know, I think when you get there, you don't want to be a fly-by-night champion. You want to be a champion of substance and someone who will take on all comers, create your own legacy and be a respected champion who lasts for a while.
Definitely. You know, when I get to the top, I'm going to take on all comers. What my plan is to do is to get to the top and let the public decide who I should fight. Give me the hardest fights. Whoever thinks they're tough guys, whoever thinks they're champions, bring them on and I'll do my best to defeat them.
Well, Tyson, it's great to speak to you.
Thank you
as always,
very much.
And appreciate it, and I wish you all the best of luck
in
the future.
Take it easy.